Hello and welcome, everyone. I'm Luis Jaramillo, the director of the Creative Writing Program at the New School, and I'm so pleased to welcome back our friends Cave Canem for the first reading of the season. We have a few people to thank here. We have Randy Brown Jr. and Julie Goldberg and Lori Lynn Turner. Thank you for all your work tonight. And without further ado, we want to get to the main part of the evening. So please welcome to the podium. She'll be taking over the evening. Nicole Seeley, poet, great poet, and Cave Canem Programs Director. Please welcome Nicole.
Good evening and welcome. Again, I am Nicole Seeley, Programs Director at Cave Canem Foundation, a national organization dedicated to cultivating the artistic and professional growth of African-American poets. Check out our table in the back where you can buy books and sign up to be on our mailing list. We have exciting programs and opportunities this fall, including a book launch at Cave Canem this Friday, 6:30 p.m., of Anna Marine Laura's limited edition letterpress poetry collection entitled Cantos. For more information, please visit cavecanempoets.org. I'd like to thank the New School's MFA Creative Writing Program, especially Luis Jaramillo and Lori Lynn Turner. We're in our second decade collaborating with the New School, and we couldn't have asked for a more generous partner. Thanks also to the Mrs. Giles Whiting Foundation, the New York State Council on the Arts, and the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, and of course, all of you for coming out tonight. It is my pleasure to introduce Metta Sáma and Timothy Liu. Metta Sáma is the author of L'Animal and Other Creatures, After Sleeping to Dream, After, Nocturne, Trio, and South of Here. Her poems, fiction, and creative nonfiction essays have been published in Heir Apparent, Apogee, Please Excuse This Poem, among others. Sáma is the director of the Center for Women Writers and an assistant professor and director of creative writing at Salem College. Timothy Liu is the author of 9 books of poetry, most recently, Don't Go Back to Sleep. His poems have appeared in Best American Poetry and the Pushcart Prize, among others. And his journals and papers are archived in the Berg Collection at the New York Public Library. He is professor of English at William Patterson University, and he lives in Manhattan and Woodstock. Metta and Tim will each read their work. Following their readings, Cave Canem fellow Zakia Henderson-Brown will moderate a conversation between them. Please welcome Metta Sáma, who will be followed by Timothy Liu.
Thank you, Nicole and Louis. Thank you for hosting us. There's somebody's play up here called Fucking Touch Screens, which looks kind of interesting. I might steal it and read it. I'm going to read from some other people's work, as well as my own work. And I'm probably not going to do much talking in between, because I'm never comfortable doing such a thing. And, you know, I hope that you bear with that and bear with me. So I'm going to start with this poem of Nikki Walschlager's in this book of hers called Houses, her poem Black House. Invisible house, flowers up in front, children sitting on the porch. He gets picked up every day to go to therapy. He has to get the other leg cut off now. What they call it? When you can still feel what isn't supposed to be there. My legs have been bothering me in the dampness, and he always thought I was a little funny because I moved in with a white man and obviously wasn't from here. I sit in my invisible house. My grandma also talks that way, somewhat. She was from the country some ways back, but she raised me, and we went to Value Village. She was practically the only white lady in there. She polka glowed when she told the checkout lady I was her granddaughter. The lady smiled like she was amused, but gently, kindly. She likes to hold my hand when we cross the street, so people wondered. They stare at us from their Munster salvage pinup trucks with collectible plate gullets, sedans too, painted safe parking lot colors, so you could get lost with a cart full of groceries, little fobs of baby food that spliff in the tin of your gland, night camping at noon. What they call it? That place the other poet talked about, fog or no headlights, room temperature, a low-grade fever from Bologna. It's possible if my elite panic was framed in blacklight, they would be coerced into box office seating. I should take a picture before the cattle adrenals finally revoke the lacing of my lavender. And I think his small town bobby socks are the new security code to get into the vomitorium. Also, fake military service records. Cops get to go on special paid leave when they murder here. You gotta be careful nowadays. The passion flower was the first state flower. Every time I write about irises in the summertime, my mother breezes her way into my syntax, a verbal play, a premeditated semicolon, a parenthesis of white skirts, a nurse's uniform. The only color gleaming through her facade is her hair, pulled back, tight as silence, persistent as hints of coded language. No colors allowed, no colors allowed, no colors anywhere. Color erased from every visible surface, are fine-tuned into the metaphor of the week. See my mother there, a quotation mark of respectability. No hair out of place, and half a dozen children with invisible whips marking their backs and ankles for days. Red whips puckering through the whitest socks, the whitest panties. The odor of bleach alone should have been enough to send the neighbors to the police. Something's afoot, they could have said. But they were white people stealing the sun from his sky. White people dying to be just a dozen shades darker. White people devastating the sun of his rays. And we devastating the color from our clothes. The very sweat of whiteness persistently mouthing, niggers here. In a town where the purest white iris replaces the passion flower without a fight. In a town where the memory of black bodies dangling like neglected daisies from the Walnut Street Bridge is covered in blue paint and new wooden planks. In a town where wild grass hides the shut down black schools, who could own up to such resentment? The shame of wanting to be one shade darker, one shade closer. Our hair struggling to be free of rubber bands reminded us of our place. The one strand never anticipating the brand of switches, the sting of a thousand swipes. An arm angrier and heavier than the tiny mother delivering the blows. The one woman reeking of bleach, swearing, baby, this is gonna hurt me more than it's gonna hurt you. I promise, okay? Chattanooga Times, July 24th, 1963. On his 16th birthday, he caught a bullet in his left shoulder, stealing Cokes from a corner grocery. The owner, another white guy, another diminishing white town. The town losing itself, resisting possibilities. Sunny day rains, scarlet begonias thrashing in dirt, and boys stealing hot Cokes. The Cokes fizz free, the Cokes for whites only. Coca-Cola calls my father by name, Sunny. Sunny with a sunshine smile. The smile even charms clouds. Sonny, who can't remember what the white man looked like, where the bullet entered, but how it burned him awake. Invisible boy no longer. Shards of glass swim furiously, frantically, in soda and dust. So I'm going to read this thing that says it's a guzzle, G-H-A-Z-A-L, and it's really not, because I have a bad relationship with form, so it never works itself out for me. But you know, I decided to take advantage of the thing not working itself out for me, and so you know, just played a little game and called it an American African guzzle. But there is no such thing called an American African guzzle. It's just a bad guzzle. It's called sign, signifier, signify, signified, an American African guzzle. I've heard death is a white man in black tie, a man captive in a trick of black. Oh, I should also tell you, I change my name quite frequently. And so back when I wrote this poem, my name was Jade. So I didn't cheat and, you know, not enter the name at the end. It's just not going to be Metta. All right. I've heard death is a white man in black tie, a man captive in a trick of black. I hear myth, an earthworm moving an inch at a time, urging black earth aside. Elms in winter displace heat, turn black as damaged snow. In theaters, before curtains release and withdraw from black, music lingers, intactly absent, silence. Exercise patience. How does black myth survive? I hear a black man in red face, red stripes slashing through hair is death. Black mothers in kitchens seduce flour into loaves of bread, and men black as coal squeeze the necks of cotton stalks, anticipate struggle, create black gospel, black blues, black jazz. Hear music's possibilities. Unrelenting black whips damage myth, their beaten backs. In Europe, the black plague created black death 200 years prior to Shakespeare's Othello, the black Moor strangled his wife, prior to the introduction of black comedy. Before the stock market collapsed in 87, brokers held Monday until it too could become black. Waiting around for another invention, Mel lost his innocence to black, then black sex, black satire, black ice. Too clever for this setup? Soon, dawn will erupt, precise, breathtaking, the un of black. And here we linger in black images, repeating phrases as if they are truth, as if the structural design of words hold black like fear. The myths fall in on themselves, but how we hunt for the blackest diamonds, the blackest metaphor. Strangers live resilient under interstate overpasses, black as exhaust and valleys of ash buds, heavy as rain clouds, infinite as nebula. On the corner, a black man contains himself in wilting dust particles, jaded as tossed napkins, spare change, coffee, crows. All right. This is In the Throat 2. It's from the poet Elmaz Abinader. This is her book. And it's in sections, they are numbered, and I'm not going to read the numbers. I'll just pause a little bit between the sections. In the Throat 2. Speech is not an act or even a formality. No reduction, denotation, inference, or entendre. It rustles the fine needles at the tops of the trees, closer to where air thins, and we starve to speak, gasp before we breathe. When I listen, language abrades the line, violates the memory of how it was dreamed, imagined, sold to the rebelling citizens. They tattooed their arms with petroglyphs of seasons. The syntax of history cracks at the seams, the clauses, major and minor, sometimes switch place, voice and silence, privacy and suspicion. Words are stolen, words repeat, slandering their past. In the diagram of these sentences, the modifiers are thorns, the nouns, thistle, making poetry near impossible. Instruments are in the wrong hands. Carve the message into the bark, a trail map in many tongues. The original intention is less important than the best intention. The sleight of hand shifts nominative and object. We cannot know if it's shadow or element. Some are born so late they have no questions. The ferns are slide rules, the petals compasses. They must get dirty to listen. Every word holds history and meaning and denies all. You can arrange and rearrange acid rain, the foliage to discoloration, fertile, futile. Remember to speak the words faithfully. Expose the translation. Unmask discourse. Placement of properties and utterances. This is a time for clarity. So I have this book that is this chapbook that's a dos a dos. So it's two books in one. So on one side is one book called After Sleeping to Dream. On the other side is called After After. One side is an imagining of Argos. You know, he was the beast with the 100 eyes that protected Hera. He was killed, you know, and then Hera was so sad that her protector died that she took his eyes and put them into flowers, and this is where we get peacock feathers. But we really, you know, don't know much about Argos. And then this other side, they're just all poems that have taken titles from paintings. So I'm going to read a couple of those. After Leonora Finney's Hurry, 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 My Dolls Are Waiting. You have learned to be alone like this, waiting. You listen to half-half moons in women's throats. Porters are suitcased, waiting to be hands handling someone else's business. Sometimes everyone is laughing, but you carry secrets. Dissolve. You are more than the fidgeting eyes you carry in your face. A guest soon. When you are more than invisible, an overstuffed chaise lounging in the dining room. What beckons you? When will you break through the grand belly? It's all an illusion, isn't it? Lemons fail to unsilence crystal bowls. A piano plays emptiness, the lonelies. White elephants flat in the carpet, and you think in martini. There is an outside world outside of here, a promise of sky in the sky. Misplaced garment bags. When he arrives, there will be a 300-year-old excuse stifled in his index finger. Who will pull an alarm? Safety devices. What are those? After Jean Dubuffet's Cours de Dame. Then I thought of the second time I almost died, the doctor who saved my sunken toe from his final tag. I wonder how my father is coping, a beer in one hand and an appointment in another. Years ago, he smoked pot with a friend and laughed irrepressibly at a rig stuck beneath a low bridge. I can't help my father. My mother says a doctor wants to remove her ovaries, both of them. She doesn't need them anymore. And my mother, she wants the doctors to pull my father's prostate clear from his groin. What does he need it for? A cat's howl, a harness of pain, will carry me far into the night. And nothing, not the boy rushing towards me, not the 57 stars limpid in the sky, not the single cigarette pack tilled into dirt, nothing will attack me more than the unbridled loneliness of that cat. I wish the night will end, complicit and helpless. I can't help but think of my dear dead friend leaking chemicals while alive, naming himself Radiation Man, amused, angry, and pissing green. No one can offer me solace. Nights I trim shrubs until they are uniform, collect the falling leaves in a slip of paper, damp from the night fog. I am alone and long for the world to capsize, to drain into the lawn of me, the way sugar water drips into veins, placebo, platonic. Then I'll yearn for everything, for nothing. So I'm going to end with some poems from this new chapbook called The Animal and Other Creatures, which the publisher did some really beautiful typesetting and illustration, and she knows how much I love animals and creatures, but how terrified I am of certain things, like cockroaches. You know, and so she had a cover that had a giant cockroach on the cover, which is, you know, now you just see his little fangs on the back, to comfort me. And then she made a little red flamingo to make me feel okay about the cockroach being there somewhere on the cover. All right, so I'm gonna end with these three poems from here. Realism, a poetics. And it starts with this epigraph from Phyllis Wheatley. Imagination, who can sing thy force? The woman's fingers are alternately two praying mantes in mid-fight, alternately the skittish legs of a rock crab, blue limbs swishing left and back to blue, mirages of packed sand, untrammeled hole, free. No life forms penetrating the small world, a hole waiting to be dug, or alternately, the world is a giant fissure of blue music, classical notes, plinking hole after hole into a theory of what. What does the mantis pray for? What does the crab skirt from? What is this life? A force of what will happen to this child I imagine living with me, with his child thoughts and his innocent ways, naive, untouched? Is that naive, to think a child I could birth be untouched by the world before its birth? I think I want to at least imagine that tiny world is somewhere. I can imagine many days with this naive child. Is Cupid's face a successful imagined birth? It gets hard, I will not lie to you, to keep it up. The dream, I will not lie to you, is hard to keep up. Where in this world can I have safe babies? Not me, not my love. We cannot have babies safe in this world. The woman's fingers are sometimes praying, and prayer is a fight, a flight. Sometimes I resent this blonde child and her blondish mother, and I hate this resentment, but God, this mother imagines a safe world for her daughter, and she will be granted it. Her daughter is a safe world I can only imagine. God, I grow weary of the imagination. So a friend, I lived in Louisiana a couple of years ago, and a friend of mine had a conversation with another friend of hers, and they were two white women. They were talking about just nature poetry, and the friend thought that it was really impossible for black people to just be in nature and enjoy nature, considering the history of enslavement and lynchings and things like this. So the friend wrote me a poem, basically asking me, what is my relationship with nature? And it was a beautiful poem, and I just started bawling immediately, you know, because I was living in Louisiana with all of these beautiful branches hitting up against my windows and thinking that I was in this protected home, you know, with these palm leaves and banana leaves somehow serving as chains on the windows. And suddenly thinking again about plantations down the road and, you know, what does it mean for me to just walk around in the world and try to feel safe, and, you know, not have to carry the past with me all of the time. So I ended up a year later writing a poem in response to her poem, and this is that piece. Another way of looking at a blackbird. The fledgling magnolias planted in an unneat row alongside DuPont Parkway will one day hide nylon resin factories, and the putrid smell the developers hope will be absorbed by thick green leaves slanted away from thicker but more fragile white petals. Baby bulbs darker brown may petal and fall to the ground, may not. There are 13 dozen blackbirds shimmering in the chemical-drenched trees, an oil-smacked palette of amethyst. They choke caw in a concrete field of browning and dead magnolia bulbs. How can I look at these petaled hands and the glittering wings of these black, they're blue birds in the south, and not see hateful white hands strangling them, branch by sorrowful branch? All right, so I'm gonna leave with this poem called Always Inside You. You are, you swallow what you see. When you see what? The needle to the record, the pine needles. Prolong this, thistled road, spruced road, the spider's long arms. Take the hand, it lines its lies in lifelines. The spider wants to be alive, and you. the water the tub held. What was poured? You were. The salt, the water turned briny. The hands, spider. The branch, the hand, the mother's hand. The tap before or after her hands turned the tap against you. Water. Want death. You smell hands. You break back. You knot and needle and spine, and you still haven't learned to swim. Your memory is briny. Our memory is cracked. The needle you break. The needle you crack. The branch that lands the hand that splits the back that spiders the hands that bend the back. Want your back smooth. Want your back back. You are not up against a wall. Learn to swim. Learn to you. You, you, you are what the lines wound. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Metta. Prayer is fight the flight. That's like, yeah, I agree. This is my last reading as Timothy Liu. After tonight, I will be Yi Fan Chu. Just wanted to let you know. I'm going to read one long poem and then one new poem. Thank you, Cave Canem. A Requiem for the Homeless Spirits. There is no language to adequately describe the Japanese crimes. Ma Jiyu, survivor. Head of a Chinese soldier with a cigarette butt in its mouth. Taken by whom? Given by whom? Who never got to see the image he'd become in the papers, in textbooks, online. An image that has outlasted whatever grave he did or did not get to have in this life. This is not how anyone would want to be remembered. Future generations thumbing through the pages, the files, printing them out on desktop printers, printing off the same screens they use to check email, surf porn. The winner of this contest will get his photo on the front page of the paper, the heads of Chinese men taken off with one stroke of a broadsword, left nameless as a pile of rocks, nameless as a headless corpse with hands bound behind its back, only the names of the winners on the front page of the Nichi Shimbun on December 13, 1937. In a language I cannot read, garlanding the photo of the smiling winners in uniform, each propped up on his own sword, an image someone else who knows the language will have to explain to me. And my hairstylist, Akiro, reads to me, contest to kill first 100 Chinese with sword extended. When both fighters exceed mark, Mukai scores 106 and Noda 105. Soon, sleep will be taken away, appetite taken away as that which clutches Akiro's throat starts to spread. A cloud that began from just two cigarettes a day. No insurance for the $800 price tag attached to each procedure, which may or may not save his life. He who's already lost half of his voice, refusing radiation for fear of losing what remains, still recognizable as he takes an electric razor to my scalp, sculpting something that will last 4 weeks at best. He who's been doing this for more than half his life, who tells me he can still eat, still sleep 8 hours a night, while handing me a card for the next visit, a date that suddenly seems farther away than ever. In a speech made in Nanjing, 7 years after the rape of Nanjing, Emperor Hirohito's youngest brother, Prince Mikasa, detailed the extent of the military atrocities against the Chinese. Copies of his statement suppressed, buried by the military authorities. A single copy exhumed 5 decades later in the parliamentary library by a Kobe University professor. Order number 119, Western Front Battle Operations, 16th Division, 20th Regiment, 1st Battalion, November 16, 1937. All provisions to be levied locally in Nanjing, meaning rape, loot, pillage, destroy. And what do American textbooks say about First Nation genocide? Beyond all those blankets laced with the pox? And what will American textbooks say about Abu Ghraib, Guantanamo, waterboarding, an extraordinary rendition 50 years from now, when history, as we all know, is written by the winners? This is not how anyone would want to be remembered. Reverend John G. Maggie, chairman of the International Red Cross Council, racing through gunfire to rescue disarmed Chinese soldiers being led off to the slaughter. Reverend John G. Maggie, an amateur photographer who obtained a permit from the Japanese authorities. The stills from his 16-millimeter movie camera largely responsible for what we're able now to see. His camera and film deposited at Yale, where he became a chaplain after the war. Photos exist. Some were rounded up with barbed wire in groups of 10 and herded down by the river where the machine guns were waiting. Some were forced to dig ditches, forced again to lie down in them, while the next group shoveled dirt on top of them, muffling their screams, others buried up to their necks, only to be beheaded, bayoneted, flattened by the treads of a tank. Some were burned alive, gasoline igniting communal pits. Photos exist. Bayonet wounds on the back of a woman's neck, severing muscles down to the vertebral column. Others gang raped week after week until they contracted venereal diseases and were taken out to be shot. Then posed for photographs, the souvenir film sent by Japanese soldiers to be developed in Shanghai, where extra prints were sometimes smuggled out to news agencies across the ocean. Memo to the 66th Regiment, 1st Battalion, December 13, 1937. Kill all captives. Few of the survivors remain alive in 2015. Few of the perpetrators remain alive in 2015. Some of their stories have been recorded. Many of their stories will never get told. What should any of us do while they are still alive? Akiro says, textbook revisions exist. Japan's aggression against northern China replaced with Japan's advance into northern China. Japan's invasion of Southeast Asia replaced with Japan's advance into Southeast Asia. Please discuss. Mukai scores 106 and Noda 105. The newspaper article, a fabrication, a complete fiction. Mukai's attorney said before the war crimes tribunal, propaganda that made for an enticing story for the two instantly famous lieutenants to seek out new brides. And when the Japanese police showed up at Mukai's door in the spring of 1947, Mukai said, "I did nothing wrong," telling his wife that the killing contest was all made up. "Oh, then, you lied to me," his wife reportedly said. Baskets of gold, baskets of jade, how can we trust the testimony of survivors not to be exaggerated? Baskets of gold, baskets of jade, all of it left behind, my mother said. When the Japanese marched toward the gates of Nanjing, my mother born in 1936, according to the lunar calendar. Never quite sure which date to officially use on her California driver's license, my mother's family who went from everything to nothing, baskets of jade, baskets of gold, hauled off by soldiers overnight. But something's not quite right, my father says, about the time and the place. She was born in Xi'an, not Nanjing. She wasn't even there when the soldiers scaled the walls after dropping ordnance sunup to sundown for weeks on end. Something must be wrong with her medication. Though it's true, my father says, her family ran from the Japs, we all did, just not in 1937. You know how she gets everything confused, baskets of jade, baskets of gold. My mother in and out of psych wards for the last decades of her life, dead at the age of 62, half a globe and more than half a century away. No way to verify exactly what she meant when she pulled a long gold hair from her own scalp and said, "You know, you must be at least an eighth German. But your father, so many things he still doesn't know." Canceling class, I stay home from school, order 3 DVDs online, and surf the web all day for atrocities. Bullet, horse urine injected into human kidneys. Bullet, animal blood injected into veins. Bullet, seawater injected into veins. Bullet, air injected into veins. Bullet, bubonic plague injected into veins. Bullet, limbs amputated, then reattached to opposite sides of the body. Bullet, flamethrower practice. Bullet, vivisection without anesthesia. Bullet, limbs frozen off till only a torso and head remained. Still breathing, eyes open. When my brother brought his girlfriend home for the first time, he thought her being Asian and a member of the college speech team would be enough. But when my parents heard her last name had a few syllables too many, Horiuchi, Yamaguchi, whatever it was, what could they do but frown and whisper to one another, "She's Japanese, so vicious." My family no longer knowing which country each of us were living in. Canceling class, I stay home from school, trying to square the accounts of just how many were massacred. 300,000, 200,000, 50,000, 50. Very little remains of the fifth grade. Only Sherry on a jungle gym at recess, chanting, "Millimated monkey meat, roasty toasty parakeet, wormy vomit flowing down the avenue, now it's time for lunch, I forgot my spoon." That and one other. Chinese, Japanese, Hercules, look at these. As Sherry rocked, back and forth, bodacious knees churning inside an oversized tea. Never asked her why she pulled the outer corner of her eyes up for Chinese and down for Japanese. Quite sure now, even she didn't know such pieces of rote performance art, how they got handed down at recess, the source of their origins unknown, at least to us, in 1976. And before they knew it, they found themselves beyond what they thought they were capable of, bayoneted survivors who felt they had no choice but to bring their trophies home, Japanese heads impaled on long bamboo poles. Little else remains for my sophomore year in college, but a course in abnormal psych, and little remains of that except for a lecture the professor gave about a serial killer who used to roam the Timpanogos Mountains on the very trails we were likely to hike as soon as school got out. Said the thing the killer liked to do most after binding his victim's wrists and ankles with duct tape was to turn on a portable cassette recorder while he chose one of the many possible blades from a Swiss Army knife his mother had given him. Curious how the wounds he inflicted would each produce a different sound as the blade went in, then out, in, out. He who'd make an archive of his research, documenting the difference between puncturing a kidney versus a liver, an eyelid instead of a spleen. And the relish our professor took, imitating some of the screams he'd heard, began to trump the facts themselves. He who had become the very thing he knew so much about, and in so doing, made the lesson all the more memorable, indelible. Inscription on the tombstone of the homeless spirits. In October of 1938, I, Gao Guan Wu, was instructed by the government to go to Nanjing. It was a year after the Nanjing incident. Remains, however, still could be found on the mountains, at the city walls, in the thick growth of grass along the rivers. I myself collected 2,600 remains in the city and buried them. 2 months later, the villagers related to me that there were more abandoned remains at Mao Shan, Ma Quan, Ma An, and Linggu Monastery. The villagers pleaded for burial of those remains. Therefore, I conveyed this matter to the Public Health Bureau. As a result, more than 3,000 bodies were collected and buried at the Linggu Monastery. This monument was erected to guard against wild beasts and to memorialize those homeless spirits. This text is from a rubbing. The stone is now lost. And I'll close with this. This is brand new. I want to thank Sarah Wetzel, who's here tonight. She's my poetry group. And if there's anything in this poem that is bad, blame her, because I asked her to vet it for me. I'm a little scared to read this poem here, but here we go. So this is Incident on 1st and 14th. Used to be on the lookout for white supremacist gatekeepers and atrocity kitsch, greasing the bodies of wannabe whores and eating in the sin. That's the difference between now and then. Hey, hey, ho, ho, shall we cancel our subscriptions to Charlie Hebdo? So what if she's got a black-faced Twitter avatar? Or if he lost 2,000 friends overnight? Because I ain't no hollaback girl. It took only 3 men to scale the 60-foot ash in my own backyard and hack that fucker down. Piece by piece, the emerald ash borer beetle having done its number all across the state. Lest we forget our hero of the hour who didn't even sport a skirt. So used to being kissed by the sun, didn't matter what race he was or if he was even a man. Rivulets of sweat skating down his back deep into butt crack mufti, demanding my unmediated response. This Caitlin, this Trayvon, this Ilan, this Yifen Chu, sucking down an entire pack of American spirits in a single afternoon while the Civil War goes on and on. Do you read me? We were born with fields of plantation tobacco in our lungs, my inner master cavorting with your inner slave. While geishas go on plucking their strings, white face caked on yellow face, hauling every Japanegro gook down the block into ass rape internment remand. Our boys overseas cracking open jars of Nutella sent by their moms. This shit's on my banana, B-A-N-A-N-A-S. This shit's on my banana, B-A-N-A-N-A-S. You sucky fucky for $5? My inner Susie Wong, all dolled up in grunt fatigues. Oh, Sally, I know speaky the English.
Thank you both for such a wonderful and provocative reading. I'm going to ask you a few questions. Feel free to ask each other questions along the way. So I want to start from a line of thinking popularized by everyone's favorite fairy godmother, Audre Lorde, who calls the erotic a resource within each of us that is firmly rooted in the power of our unexpressed or unrecognized feeling and a source of power and information. I've had the privilege and the opportunity to get familiar with a wide range of your works, and you both engage the erotic in your works in very different ways. Can you talk a little bit about the function of the erotic in your poems?
This is on? I'm not sure how to answer a good question, so I'm not sure how to answer this question. I can say that I think about the erotic often. I write about it. I look for it in my day-to-day activities. One of the things that she said in that essay is that she feels this extraordinary joy when she's doing daily tasks, right? Like washing her dishes or putting together a bookshelf, and that it's the same kind of joy that she feels when she's having sex. And so that's something that I'm often looking for, and something that I feel like I'm often missing. I think I'm more in the world of, there was an NPR segment on happiness, and people who experience happiness are people who lie a lot. And that people who tend to not lie and kind of live in this reality are very often unhappy and often depressed. So I'm in that world, I'm in that category of people. That I'm so often looking for justice and looking for ways to work for justice and work towards justice. That there's just no filter. It's just an attempt that I have that doesn't actually happen. And so the only way that I imagine finding joy, finding this kind of deep erotic power, is in writing about all of this justice.
Thank you.
I mean, that's a pretty radical idea that people who lie are happier, right? But we all agree, right? I mean, I just am noticing the sort of erotic barometric reading in this room is not very high right now. And maybe 4 hours from now, you will be engaged in a more erotic activity, right? And so what that reminds me of is that for a lot of our lives at work, in school, riding the subway, our erotic lives are not expressed. And so it's not a surprise that you sit down and write a poem that you can't quite plug into that energy. And another sort of paradox, if you're fucking a lot, right, you're probably not writing a lot of poems. Right, so there's this weird negotiation of sublimation that goes on. And what I would say is, if we pay attention to our erotic energy daily and acknowledge that most of the time it doesn't find expression, then our job is to sort of pay attention to that in ourselves so that we can sort of bring that to the page.
Thank you. Do each of you consider yourselves to be writing out of a particular tradition, or against it, or away from it?
Am I going to keep going first?
No, I'll go first. I started with a pretty traditional training as far as the 19th century romantics, syllabics, meter, and stuff like that. So I had to break from that, in a way. And then once you break from forms handed down, you never leave them completely. I love writing villanelles and sestinas and sonnets, you know, from time to time. But you're also free to invent your own forms. And so that's the thing that's really crucial, is there are so many other examples of poems in invented and often radical forms, you know, last 50, 80 years, that there's just so much to pay attention to. And so what you end up finding is that it's kind of all the same thing. You know, so what you think you're rebelling or revolting against mm-hmm. turns out to be a process that's actually shared.
So I came to poems, reading poems and making poems very late in life. And so because of that, because I came very late and was found myself just suddenly in an MFA program and feeling very uncertain about where I was, and also having spent, you know, a couple of semesters as an undergrad with people talking about this rawness in my work, that was the thing that I was really trying to hold on to and to not be inside of any tradition, you know, because the books that we were reading, the material that we were reading, nobody was calling that work raw, you know, like it was very polished, it was cooked, you know, I mean, there was an essay, right, the raw and the cooked, you know, we all wanted to write the cooked poem or whatever, but I wanted to hold on to a rawness, and because I have a bad relationship with authority, you know, so it's very difficult for me to deal with rules. I write really bad formal poems, you know, and so I was always kind of outside of that tradition and really trying to understand mostly forms in terms of, you know, when they were created and how they were created, for what audience, for what purpose, and really having a very hard time understanding why we were still working in those forms hundreds of years later and in a different place, and who's making the new forms, and, you know, like what formal energies are speaking to the now, you know, and I think that those are mostly structural poems and not formal poems. They don't really have rules. So if I am inside of a tradition, it's in that tradition of trying to create new structures and new forms that speak to where we are now and the kinds of ways that we're thinking in the now. So I do mostly a lot of experimentation, but I'm not in the camp of experimental poets.
Right. You're kind of in the middle. You did experiment with the guzzle in the reading, and I thought you were very successful at that.
You didn't see the thing on the page, but yes.
So I think historically poets have had a relationship to other art forms. Tim, I know you're a fan of classical music, and it shows up in some of your work. And Metta, you had a collection that was based off the titles of paintings. And so I guess if you could talk about how important other art forms are in your own writing.
Sure. So I say this quite often. It's very difficult for me to find words. I'm a visual person. I'm a visual thinker. So I see in images and think primarily in images. So I look towards art quite frequently, towards visual art. I listen to a lot of music. I'm very, I rely on music, rhythms, intonations, speech patterns in my work. But mostly looking at visual art, particularly abstract art or avant-garde art, is kind of where I go.
I think paying attention to what gives our lives depth is really crucial to our task as writers. And so it's not surprising that the music we're obsessed with or the visual art that really engages us and that starts, you know, fucking with our dream life, for example, that somehow that's going to wind its way into our practice. I mean, it would have to. I would say that as a language whore and not a language sex worker, that doesn't quite sound right, right? The language whore, like when I go to MoMA, I often find it's less the painting on the wall than the little writing next to the painting that inspires me to write about art. Because there's something about the language of description, whether by an artist statement or better even an art critic, it's the way that they put words together that really like fires me up. And I actually have never said that, but I do think it's true. And I think, for example, listening to a piece of jazz, you know, let's say you're listening to, I don't know, Art Blakey or something. There's something about reading liner notes. There's something about reading these old reviews in jazz magazines, coupled with whatever the art form is, that gets a kind of weird conversation going. Mm-hmm. I just want to say that. So in a way, what you're doing is you're not just ekphrastically responding to a work of art, you're also responding to text that somehow has attached itself to that form. And that somehow both of those things together start doing a little dance up here somewhere, I think.
Sure. I think that sounds right to me. I think conventional wisdom suggests that poets throughout their careers will return again and again to the subjects that most intrigue them, obsessions, some personal obsessions, because they might be inescapable. What are some subjects that you both keep returning to?
I write a lot about the body. Although I'm not often conscious of it, I am now in this new project that I'm working on, but I write a lot about religion. You know, which I guess makes sense. I grew up in the South, my parents became Muslims when I was 11. And so, you know, when you're in the South and it feels very Baptist, very Bible Beltish, you know, and then your parents are Muslims, religion is there constantly. It's just so frequent. And before they were Muslims, we went to my grandfather's church. So, you know, we were just dealing with religion all of the time. So it's just something that somehow enters into my vocabulary. I notice that I call God's name quite frequently in my work. You know, so I think that those are the two things for me. It's really just the body and God.
Me too. I mean, because I always come back to Koch. You know, I find Koch kind of endlessly interesting. I mean, I'm turning 50 next month, and I still like Koch as much as I ever have. And I worship it. And so it does appear in my poems as well. But I think the thing is, okay, this is what Jung said, is he said that we really get to our art in the best way if we write out of the weak side of our psyche. Right, this is why he was really into doing what we call shadow work, the stuff that we don't want to look at or own in ourselves. So I have had to ask the question recently in the last year why I tend to steer away from writing about being an Asian American, for example. Right? And it's not that I haven't enjoyed and been harmed by this identity, by, you know, wearing this body. But for some reason, I have been kind of shy about it. I just thought, of all the things I'm into, that's not something that I want to delve into. And so I have found it kind of nourishing and challenging to, for example, engage that. So even the poem that I read today about the rape of Nanjing, it was a way to sort of address this weird inheritance I had before I was born that affected my mother, certainly, and then how it played itself out when I was growing up in California. And I think even tonight, the newest poem that I read to you, I'm trying to work through some really tangled stuff. And so for example, it's so cute. I just want to point out, you guys are both wearing yellow tonight, which because—
total coincidence.
Right, because in my mind, the black-yellow relational thing is really tricky. It's really interesting. I mean, when I think of black-white or white-yellow, I've spent more time in those situations, right? And so even that is like a new, it's like, you know, I hope I don't say the wrong thing tonight. You know, I'm here at a Cave Canem event. And so these are real things. These are actually real anxieties and fears that we carry. And so I feel like when I'm writing, I try to pay attention, what is it that is causing me anxiety and fear, and to try to move a little bit in that direction. And so what happens is, hopefully, as we're aging and maturing in life, that we are growing. And then maybe the things that really consumed and obsessed us 20 years ago, some of those hopefully have been laid to rest, right? And that then gives us an opportunity to sort of look at the new things on the horizon that are sort of coming into view, right? Because there's still tons of things going on in our psyches that we're not going to look at for a while, mm-hmm. right? We're just not ready. So I think as a writer, that's one of our tasks, as people breathing air, is to try to become conscious of what is just coming into view that we can actually start working with, right? Whether in our lives or on the page.
Yeah, and I think just as a quick follow-up to the obsessions and the sort of things you keep returning to, do you feel freed by your obsessions, or do you feel trapped by them?
I would say that our obsessions, in addition to our dream life, are the two things that can point the way to what makes our life meaningful. Sure. Now, I'm going to give a weird example. So let's say you're a porn addict, right? Some of you in this room are, I saw you, you're looking at porn during her reading. And I was just like, whoa, you know? But let's say you're a porn addict. Is that meaningful? Right, if you're an alcoholic who's never stepped in the 12-step rooms, is that meaningful? You know, if you just like to be beat up by a dominatrix every night, is that meaningful? I don't know. I actually think that sounds like you're trapped. Mm-hmm. Sounds hellish. Mm-hmm. And we all know people like that, and we've all been there, right? So it's not exactly like an equation, is it? But what I would say is if we pay attention to our obsessions but not necessarily act them out, mm-hmm. then we might be curious what's the source behind them. Yeah. And that can be very deep and rich.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I don't feel trapped by obsessions. I don't realize that I have them until I'm looking back at something. So I didn't realize how much I wrote about race, for example. You know, until I started looking back at things and realizing that race comes up so often in almost everything that I'm writing about, right? Mm-hmm. You know, and that I think that I'm thinking about something else or writing about something else, and suddenly I'm writing about race, you know, mm-hmm. or I'm trying to turn my head into a different direction and something happens in the world, you know, something, you know, comes up on the news, and suddenly it's kind of like that little obsession is there, and it's just so happy that something has happened so I can go back and focus on it, you know, but in my head, I'm really obsessed with other things, you know, so, you know, it's just, I guess it's that kind of weak part of the mind, you know, that is just there, you know, so yeah, I don't know, I never feel trapped. About anything, I don't think. I hope not.
I mean, if I add something super basic to what you said, I would say that we write out of our wounds. Mm-hmm. And I would say as readers, we love finding texts that actually read into our wounds so that we see the language for states that we've felt and have been troubled and traumatized by. And we may not even have the ability to make art out of it yet, but then we read someone's stuff and it's like, whoa, thank you for saying that. I needed to hear that. So it's a very sort of basic level, but I think that's why when you look at a painting or hear a piece of music and it kind of blows your mind and it just stays with you, you're communing with it. You're one, it's speaking to you. And then I think as creators, we want, hopefully, it's almost redeeming that if you could examine a wound and make art and it then helps someone else wherever they are, you've given something back, right? And I think that's the most basic exchange that seems real to me.
Thank you. So you both have written some poems that attempt to reckon with a violent and racialized past. And I think that there's a history of poets doing that. And And I think that, that their function is that they kind of add some cultural undergirding to political discourse. And so I guess I'm wondering what your hope is for these types of poems, and then even on a more basic level, what do you think a poem can do or a poet can do in relation to sort of a certain political moment?
Well, for me, on a deep level, it's doing the inner work. I mean, right now we live in a kind of socially mediated time where we have this kind of mob mentality where people just comment reflexively and reactively, and they just take down people, right? And I mean this as a really bad pun, and they shoot Sherman Alexie full of arrows, right? That's what's going on this week, right? And we have to look at that and say, and be curious and say, why is this happening, right? And I would say it's because so many people right now feel fucked up, and but they don't know how to even do the inner work of looking at their own racism. And so what do we end up doing is we scapegoat someone and we slap on the labels, right? Racist, sexist, homophobic, right? And I think that in when you're working, especially in your art, you really want to sort of like not be laying the blame at other people's doorsteps, but use it as an opportunity to turn inward and to see what kind of muck is really down there. And I think that kind of work of art can be very transformative, right? So when I think about, I was thinking tonight a little bit of Audrey Rich. And I was thinking, what was so great about her is when you read a book of hers, like an Atlas of the Difficult World or Dark Fields of the Republic, or two books I go back to a lot, she's working out a lot of shit inside of herself. Mm-hmm. She's angry, but she's not willing to just sort of, you know, put all these sort of little blame labels and find all these scapegoats. Mm-hmm. And I think that that's one of the things that art can call us to do. It's a meditative practice. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping that even if the poem or the work, you know, of prose is even not very good, if it in some ways has transformed the writer to work through something, then that's still good for us,
yeah,
right, for the community. And then on top of that, we also hope that the work of art actually might be transformative for other people. And I'll just add, the depressing thought, of course, is that someone can make a really great work of art and they're just a fucking asshole. Right, a total racist, sexist, homophobic pig, and yet they've wrote a beautiful poem, and that happens, mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah, of course, we're all flawed. but then the question is, do we have to buy that art? So I guess I'm, you know, I'll go the opposite way of that, you know, that that I think that, you know, what, I mean, I don't know what art can do. I can see that what is happening for poets with social media, having access suddenly to other people who have been violated and have been harmed for decades and have had no outlets, have had no voices, have not been able to speak, have been silenced, are suddenly finding avenues, pathways to find other people who are also being harmed and are speaking collectively. I think that's a different way to phrase something like mob mentality, right? Mm-hmm. I think the mob mentality becomes a way to continue to silence people who have been silenced for decades. You know, and so that when we then see someone who is harming a community and we're part of that community, then we now have this social media network to come together and speak together, right? And to find ways to keep moving forward and to generate art from that. So that, you know, what I've seen happening, Nikki's book, for example, that I read from, you know, Nikki, I watch make spaces for poems in social media, right? You know, that she's using this space to mediate these intense feelings that she's having about all of this stuff that's affecting her personally and affecting the various communities that she's in. You know, so that she's taking these things and updating about them and transforming them into art, right? You know, so she has a chapbook that just came out from Bloof that's all memes of, you know, this black woman who says very, you know, kind of quick, sassy things about you know, all of the various racial violences, for example, that's happening in the literary world, you know, so that to me feels actually like a wonderful space. That begins to feel like an erotic space, you know, that people find each other and find fuel, you know, and the right kind of fuel that they have been searching for, you know, that hasn't been available to them. For myself, for my own practices, you know, there's, you know, this journal that's going to publish these essays that I presented with a group of people at AWP, you know, and I think that this essay begins with something like, I'm so tired of talking about race. I don't want to talk about race anymore. You know, and then, of course, afterwards, I'm talking about race constantly, you know, because we somehow don't know how to talk about something deeper than race, something like more foundational, more grounded than race, like white supremacy, which is really not just about race, right? Like it's class and gender and all of these kinds of things. But I think that it's very difficult to do these kinds of things when suddenly you're now fighting someone who you think is in your community because they're out there saying you're, you know, all of these people, you now have this mob mentality and people trying to kind of police the way that you speak and the tones that you use and the words that you use and the actions that you use. So that now we all have to be very graceful in the way that we use language to arm ourselves and fight. Otherwise, you know, we're sharks, we're vicious, you know, we're dogs, right? Mm-hmm. You know, going after the hunt or something like that. And that becomes really problematic because now you're being silenced by your own community and then your art suffers. Right, you know, so I just see it in a very different kind of pathway, you know, that I've actually seen it create stronger art from people than I think they would have been able to produce prior to this, right? You know, because before you're kind of writing with a straitjacket on, you know, trying to please gatekeepers who turn out to actually not care about you at all anyway, you know.
Well, if I could put a finer point on what I meant by mob mentality, I have nothing against people being sharky and angry. I think that's really powerful. I just think it's better if they wait and respond verbally, either in speech or writing, after an initial reactionary period. That's called maturity, mm-hmm. like waiting and sort of sitting with the feeling before you act. And then if you want to be sharky, great. But I think a lot of times what happens is foment gets whipped up. Whoa, that's cool. Foment gets whipped up in the moment and it's fine. And people are acting out all sorts of strong feelings, but it's not very interesting yet. Mm-hmm. It's just, you know, it's a very classic thing if you've ever been to couples therapy. Is one of the things they tell you is there's the emoting part and then the discussing part. And people often confuse the two things because they literally act as different parts of our brain. So you're taught very gradually how to do the emoting and get down there and get to all that rage. Fine, right? But then at some point, then it's you do the talking part. And I call that the writing part.
Well, I'll also say that, I mean, I guess, you know, the other part of that is that you know, the emoting part of it may seem immature, but it's also a way to not kill yourself with stress, you know. And so I'm very conscious of Black women in academia, for example, who have died from cancer, you know, because of all of the stressors and all of the ways in which they're told that, you know, the proper response is just to swallow it, to work it out in your own head, or to go to therapy, or to deal with it privately, and then at what point do they actually get to speak, right? You know, the moment in which they actually get to speak is suddenly closed, and when they try to bring it up again, well, that thing is old, why are you bringing this old thing up again? You're trying to start a problem, you're now, you know, a provocateur, you're an instigator, you know, blah, 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 right? So it's kind of like damned if you do, damned if you don't, you know, in that really, really real way, right? You know, and so my feeling is that social media is the one reality that we have, that we can actually push this thing called an off button and walk away from it if there's something happening that you don't want to see, right? You know, so unlike a therapist, when you're stuck with a couple, you know, you have to listen to them. If you don't want to listen to all of this stuff that's going on Facebook, turn it off. Come back the next day, right? You know, or unfollow those people. They won't show up in your newsfeed, right? Like, you really don't have to see these things, you know? So there's a way to self-control instead of telling people how to act and how to behave just because you don't want to see it or just because you're bored by it, you know? That to me feels kind of anti-human, which feels a little anti-art in and of itself.
So it's getting late, yeah, but I do, I want to give the audience, our diminishing audience, an opportunity to ask some questions, but very, very quickly, I'm curious about both of your thoughts on, the Best American Poetry, debacle. Sherman Alexie is one of my favorite writers. I think he is, he is kind of a trickster, like a literary trickster, and like is comfortable being subversive. I think a lot of people don't agree with the choices that he made or his defenses of himself. But I think the larger issue, which is the sort of cultural appropriation and the literary yellow face of Michael Derek Hudson, it's a bigger question about sort of like what are the ethical boundaries of the literary community that we're creating. So it's just an open-ended question. I'd love to hear your thoughts on it.
Well, I have given this question some thought, and I'll say something irreverent first, which I mentioned to Robert Polito tonight, and I just said irreverently, I wish he would have checked his ego, Michael Hudson, and not have revealed that he was Yifan Xu. I think if in Best American Poetry, he just created a bio for Yifan Xu and then spoke with the impersonation intact, that would have been awesome. And so actually his needs, his ego needs to be a Best American Poet and to sort of say, ha ha, I pulled this off. I think that was a big mistake. Okay, now people are saying, oh, no one's ever gonna read him again. I'm like, no, he can just invent another pseudonym. You know, I mean, who's to say in this room right now there aren't many of us who publish under different names? Mm-hmm. Why on earth would I ever tell you what those other names are? I just wouldn't do that. But it doesn't mean I won't go on doing it. Okay, so that's one thing to think about. The other thing, of course, is that, of course, people are super upset. I have I'm on a group, I don't know what they call it, a Facebook group with 500 people, Asian American writers who are upset about this thing, mm-hmm. Right? And so this thing that I just shared with you tonight, I did not say that on my little group, right? Because I'm also sensitive to how they're feeling, and I don't want to just like, yeah, you know, and stuff like that. But I'll give you an anecdote. So this is a sort of roundabout way to approach a question. So I'm working with a grad student at my school, Howard. I've known him for 5 years. He's white, he's my age, he's a Tai Chi instructor. And the other day I just said, hey, you know, do you know about this sort of Best American Poetry scandal right now? And I just said, do you have a Chinese name? And he said, yes. In fact, a Tai Chi master gave him a Chinese name, and not only that, gave him a chop that has the Chinese name carved into it, you know, so that you can stamp it. And I said, Howard, would you ever publish your poems under that name? And he said, of course. And I said, I fully support it.
So the thing that you left out in both of these things are intent, right? Like intention, and this dude's intention, as he said in his bio, was to publish as a Chinese author because he wasn't being published enough as a white author. And that actually, I think, changes everything. And I think that's why people were upset about it. You know, but we also, unless any of us know Michael Derek Hudson or have talked to Sherman Alexie, none of us know why this dude revealed himself as part of that bio in Best American Poetry, right? So this could have been something that Sherman asked him to do. We really don't know why he revealed himself in that bio. You know, so for me, it's not even worth speculating about, you know, until we know. My feeling about Sherman's decision after reading his response on the Best American Poetry blog was that 10 years ago, well, 9 years ago in 2006, he was feeling quite differently when a white man impersonated being a Native American and wrote a memoir, you know, as a Native American person. And he actually, you know, wrote an essay in Time magazine about it, contacted the guy's publisher, said to the guy's publisher, this dude is not Native American. I think he's some angry white guy. You know, here's why I think he's not a Native American. You know, there were articles about this. And Sherman ended his article in Time magazine saying, you know, I wish that a public figure who had some power and some authority would do the right thing and step up and call this dude out, right? So that's kind of how I'm feeling about this right now, right? You know, is that when this happens to a Native American community, that he has one response, now he has a different response, call it maturity, you know, 9 years has passed, you know, or whatever, but it feels to me that he's not taking it seriously, you know, because it's not happening to his community or to him, you know.
I mean, oh, go ahead.
I don't really feel that upset by Michael Hudson's intent. I mean, if I look into myself, the shadow work that needs to be done is, I think what people are upset about is he blazingly, you know, like this ambition, right? This is what people are upset. And I don't know. Every writer I ever met is wildly ambitious for their own career, and they want their work to be received well. And I guess some people would never consider even taking a pseudonym, let alone a cross-gendered pseudonym or adopting a different race, right? But I think the issue here, I mean, it's funny, like Craig Santos Perez, you know, was very funny in his response, and he talked about, this was a guy named Orlando White, right, talked about, well, if this guy, Michael Hudson, was Michael Black Elk Cloud or something, maybe, you know, it wouldn't have flown under Sherman Alexie's radar. And I just kind of chuckled. I thought, yeah, he has a point, but to me, it's no difference. Like, I don't change my mind because he chose Yifan Chu rather than Michael Black Cloud, I mean, or Elk Cloud. It's the same thing. And I do think, I mean, these are complex issues, so I really want to keep it 3D and not be this way or that way. I didn't know that Yifan Chu is a real person that he went to school with, and that, you know, his sister is a lawyer in D.C.
She is a girl.
She.
Yes, it's a
yeah.
woman.
Yeah. That's what I said.
You said he.
Did I used, because I was talking, referring to Michael.
Oh, yeah.
All right. But yeah, Yifan Chu is a girl, and her sister lives in D.C. and is a lawyer, and actually wrote out against how much this has damaged the sister's name.
Oh my goodness.
So to me,
a writer?
No, she's not a writer.
Oh, okay.
But this is the added thing that I thought, well, it's one thing if you vent a pseudonym, but if you actually use the name of a real person that you went to school with, it you know, all these real facts I think have to be taken into consideration. Mm-hmm. So I do agree with you that if we know what his intent is, we might feel differently about his choice.
Well, I also just want to say that, you know, his intention as well, you know, as stated in his bio, you know, we're already in a moment that I think that publishers are finally starting to deal with the lack of diversity in literature. And, you know, him saying that having this Chinese name is going to get him published, whereas having this white name is not getting him published, although he'd already been published twice in Poetry Magazine. In Poetry Magazine, had won a major award in England, you know, like 10,000 pounds or something, under Michael David Hudson or whatever his name is, right? Like, he'd already used that name and had gotten success, you know, so that using the name because you're now suggesting that Chinese writers are getting ahead just on a name and not on their work turns the way that I think we have to now look at diversity in publishing, right? And there's also just this underlying idea that Chinese poets are mediocre, you know, and that is their name that's getting them published and not the work itself. So for me, it actually does a lot of damage to the whole people of color, like writers of color are really damaged by this idea that Sherman then takes and calls racial nepotism, you know, which I think we should all take 20 years to just unpack, you know, what the hell that even means, racial nepotism.
But I think even that idea that you're proposing or repeating is under scrutiny. I mean, people, and I'll just take it back to him since he's the one who did it. I mean, the logic that he has already made a name for himself with his real name, right? But then when he sent this poem around 40 times, he thought, okay, I'll just slap an Asian woman name on this and see how that does, and it gets picked up. It seems like, okay, so part of me is like, I don't really think of it as a big deal. I mean, okay, I know.
We don't know anything about it. We don't know anything about it, right?
So
did he send it? Yes, I am. I'm sorry. I am interrupting you. Did he send? I'm interrupting. Did he send this poem 40 times to 40 journals, and then under Yifan Chu, send it to 9 of the 40 journals that he'd already sent it to? Did he send it to 9 other journals? What was the time difference between those things? Had the readership changed? Had the editorial team changed? We don't know any of this stuff. His math is really bad, right? So that he's just making us feel something without any actual material evidence to support anything that he said, right? You know, I mean, poets send stuff to like 75 journals and get rejected before, you know, it finally gets picked up. That's the process. That is the process.
But also, we'll forget in 2 months from now. I mean, like, I think about all the sort of hoaxes we've lived through. I was just thinking the other day, wasn't it 10 years ago that someone, like, stole Neil Bauer's poetry and published them, right? Like, verbatim. I don't know if you remember that, but wouldn't you be upset if you opened a magazine like Poetry and your poem is in there exactly the way you wrote it with someone else's name on it? And then you look in another magazine, it happens again. That's what happened to this guy, Neil Bowers. Mm-hmm. Now,
it happened to Sandra Beasley.
Sandra Beasley, right? It's happened to a student of mine.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah.
You know, this stuff kind of goes on. I have to say there's a part of me that kind of chuckles. I know. Some of you are going to think, you know, what's that about? But there is a kind of lightness here. I don't think of Michael Hudson as a pariah, Kate Gale, David Fenza. They have to answer for what they've done, right? And I think we need to afford them that opportunity, and then you can decide. I agree with Metta that there's a lot we don't know, and I appreciate that. I think that's wise. I think we sit back and say, here's some things we know, here's some things we don't. And this is where I do like the part of me that's still archaically Christian, that I like this idea that we don't have to judge people because we don't know enough. Right, but we can have feelings about it. And my feelings happen just to be, I kind of laugh about the whole thing. Because I don't think in the end it's that big a deal. But I know a lot of my friends who are writers are super upset. So I try not to rub in their face, oh, lighten up. I try to understand why they're so upset. But I don't share that feeling.
Are there any other questions from the audience?
I think we should drink.
Yeah.
I agree.
You said what?
Drink.
All right.
There's some wine here.
I'd like to keep this thread rolling. I know it's kind of a problematic one, but so y'all have talked about the sort of the race aspect of what this guy whose three-part name I can never actually remember actually did. What about the gender bending aspect? Mm. That didn't come up.
Yeah. I didn't know until just now that even she was a woman.
A
real woman.
A real woman.
Which is,
yeah, I mean, I think that when the name was first, you know, when we all saw it, and that was, by the way, not the first reveal. I just want to be very clear about that. The guy, people, his friends knew, You know, so there was a Chinese American woman who talked in one of these private groups for women writers about meeting him face to face, that she was introduced to him through a friend of his, you know, who told her about his publications in poetry and that he had a poem coming up in Best American Poetry, you know, blah, blah, blah. You know, but he introduced him as his real name and, you know, asked this woman, like, to bring him to a reading series, right? You know, like, this is a really fine poet, just bring him to this reading series. So, I mean, people did know that he was doing this, you know, which, again, is kind of the question about why he outed himself in Best American Poetry. But I think that, you know, a lot of us assume this name was a woman's name, but then someone who was Chinese said that Yifen could also be a male name, you know, and so no one knew which way to think about the name, you know, and then when it was revealed that this was a woman that he went to high school with, the articles that I started to see about this and the feedback that I started to see about this were questions about his relationship with women, you know, how he felt about women. They started looking at his poems about women and examining the ways that he thinks about women, you know, is just the same way that he thinks about Chinese Americans, right? That they're just flat figures that can be taken and worn at his leisure, right?
Well, it's an interesting question, isn't it, about gender? Because I think about the poet Linda Smuckler, who's now Samuel Ace, right? So there's a transgender F to M writer. And I think of Trace Peterson, right, who was Tim Peterson, and now Trace. Well, with them, we say, well, you've changed your life, right? You crossed over, so I guess you get to change your name. But we're talking about pseudonyms, and I think anyone in this room who wants to take on a cross-gender pseudonym, I think it's great. What I think is more complex, okay, so I had this fantasy when, in my younger days, I thought it'd be fun to publish in Calix out of Oregon, and they only publish women. So I invented a female pseudonym for myself, but then I never sent the poems, right? But I thought about it because I thought it'd be fun to pass. Right? So it's just like when I do drag and I get on a subway, I like it when no one looks at me, because then I pass. Right? So there's that feeling of literary passing and getting away with something that's a fun challenge. I don't think anyone's really hurt. Now, some people might say, oh, if you had done that and you took a slot, then you took a slot away from a real woman, and that woman is what the magazine's intended for. And that has to be considered, right? Likewise, you know, and you guys are going to think me awful, so I'm just really letting you know I'm a shithead. So I did think back in the day, what if I could send a poem to Callaloo, right? And just to see if I could pass, but I never did. I never did. But I was curious because a friend of mine did publish a poem in Callaloo, and he was white, but he was like 1/16th African American, right? And also the subject of his poem was about this very thing. That in the lineage, if you go back, you know, four generations, you know, one of his ancestors did have someone black in the lineage. And it's really a great moment to see that poem in Callaloo, because I thought everyone thinks you're white. Like, for example, now I'm careful, like, I don't know if I want to out a poet. So I'm going to say there is a very famous American poet who is just a very small percentage African American, and he doesn't mind talking about it, but a lot of people would never know. And he passes for white, right? And he's, you know, he's been an academy of, a chancellor at the academy. And it becomes interesting when these things start to blur, because we have such an investment with gender identity and racial identity. When these categories come along that we're not quite sure where to put it, it's a little bit, it makes us feel all uncomfortable.
I don't know that Callaloo, I don't know when this happened, but I don't know that they exclusively publish black writers. I don't know if that's...
Well, they also said writing that has to do with the African diaspora. So at that point, you're freed if the content of your poem, right, sort of plugs into that in some fashion.
Yeah.
I think the goal is still to prioritize writers of the African diaspora. But are there other questions?
Could I ask one question? First of all, thank you for the
Nicole's going to give you a mic.
Thank you. Hello? Yes, okay. Sorry. First of all, I think your questions are amazing. So really thank you to the moderator for asking great questions, because not only are the poets answering really complex questions, I think the questions themselves are very interesting.
Thank you.
I'm Tim's husband. I just need to say that.
Okay.
Just
white boy.
if I could just ask an opposite question that you all are making me think about, and that is, what is your relationship to the Orthodox? And that is your, you know, buck the system, and I'm not going to say bad boy because that's old and sexist, but you know what I'm saying, you know, like, I'm tearing out of this, my shell or whatever this thing everyone thinks of me, and I'm going to do this thing that's, you know, bad, because that's really also who I am. I wonder if you could also speak to that too. Thanks.
So I'll answer in a way that I think I understand the question. So in one way of living, I'm extraordinarily considerate, to a fault. And so I always consider the source, right? I'm always considering who could be hurt by my actions. I'm always considering what work has been done to get people where they are, to get us where we are, right? So in those ways, it's, for me, a question of consideration and a question of ethics, which I have so much of, that my dad is always like, you know, your ethics are gonna destroy you, So that's that. So in terms of thinking about, the things that Tim finds irreverent, I don't find them irreverent. I find them inconsiderate of people who have fought to make space for people who have been oppressed and silenced by men, and by white people in this world, by heterosexual people in this world, and so bucking a system is bucking white supremacy that has kept so many of us under, right? And I think that is not really bucking the system so much, although I guess people who support white supremacy would see it as bucking the system, but I don't, think of this Michael Derrick Hudson performing Yellow Face and performing Woman as bucking the system. I find it a white man who is using his power as a white man to get more as a white man. And it doesn't feel rebellious. It doesn't feel renegade. It doesn't feel like anything other than a white dude saying, I want more, 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 more.
Well, I would just think that there's a very ambitious person inside all of us that wants more and more. Every single one of us in this room, I do believe that. Also, I would think you would agree with me that we've been silenced by black women in our lives. Has that ever happened?
No.
In what way? Well, how about start with your mothers? I mean, this is like a fundamental thing. I've been silenced by every category of person that's walked this earth that I've encountered from time to time. And so the thing that I find a little bit dangerous is if we wave the flag of white supremacy, that what's put in the shadow is what? Black women don't silence people? Some do. And the considerate ones refrain, right? The ones who are a little bit more spiritually advanced, just like the white men who are a little bit more developed, tend to refrain from silencing women or homosexuals or Asians or blacks. So this is a human thing that we do. And I'm just a little bit sensitive to that it's so easy to scapegoat, you know, the white supremacist man, you know, shame on him, blah, blah, blah. But I think it all goes around.
Tim, I think that because we're all human and we're all complex, that's probably true at some point or another. You've used your power, whatever, you know, power you have to take something away from someone, how, you know, on whatever scale. But I think the thing that it sounds like you are kind of that's outside of that analysis is that we don't live in a historical vacuum. And so at this moment, so if I, throughout this whole conversation, kept cutting you off, like that could mean something in this moment. But there's no real historical context for it. So you can't say, you wouldn't be able to say, oh, but look at this long history of black women oppressing and taking the power away and using all the ways that history has privileged black women to take power away from Chinese men.
Yes, I completely agree. I'm not making that claim.
Okay, yeah. I just wanted to clarify because we, you know, we live within our context.
You know, I mean, I do just want to go back to what she said. I think that there, for me, is always a big problem to turn the tables against what is being talked about in order to not talk about the thing that's being talked about, right? So to kind of turn the gaze to say, oh, you know, well, white men have historically silenced and oppressed and we're living under that, to walk away from that and say, well, hasn't a black woman shut you up? You know, it's really just keeping the problem alive, right? You know, not being able to actually move forward and have a conversation about something that is uncomfortable and painful, you know, to kind of force us to be human and have ambition. You know, so it's just like suddenly you're speaking for me and saying that I must want more and more and more because I'm a human being, instead of asking me if I want more and more and more because I'm a human being, so that then I can turn the table and say, well, hey, haven't we all been silenced by a Chinese man in our lives? No, I haven't. You know, I have not, right? So, you know, that for me just kind of presents a big problem, just not looking something directly in the face and sitting with discomfort for a long period of time, and allowing that discomfort to be there versus stepping outside of history and somehow erasing history and invalidating all of us in the process.
Well, I think I would just say that I'm a kind of both and kind of dude, so that talking about one thing doesn't erase the other. And I mean, have I ever been silenced by Chinese men? Sure, right? Because I hang out with Chinese men. That's all, that's my point. I understand what you guys are saying, is if we're talking about white privilege editorially, and also the greed of some white dude in the Midwest, okay. That's a very valid thing to talk about. But I think that I'm really into people doing the inward work and looking at their own culpability, period. Because we just happen to live in America, so we have these certain literary histories and racial challenges here, but the mechanism is the same in all these other countries I've been in, right? It's just the variables change. Mm-hmm. So there's something about it that seems very human to me. And I'm very grateful that I don't feel silenced by either of you, right? And I'm just saying that in general, I don't want to silence the white heterosexual men in the room either, right? And that there's a danger sometimes to do that, so.
I think probably less of a danger, but sure.
Yeah, I agree,
yeah,
less.
Far less, yeah.
Yeah, I agree. And I mean, I also think that, you know, the challenge of talking about oppression means that if a person is, you know, particularly, you know, if white people are feeling silenced, you know, because we're talking about white supremacy, then that is inner work for them to do, you know, because that is not actually what's happening, right? White people know how to talk about white supremacy as well, you know, and they know how to talk about historical acts of oppression within their own communities and how that affects their communities and how they see that affecting the rest of us. So I don't think that it's actually a silencing mechanism. I think that it's a space for conversation, you know, and maybe that's because I'm from the South, you know, and we don't hide at all, right? You know, we have these conversations with each other. You know, I talk to white people more frequently about white supremacy than I talk to any other group, you know.
And let's end it there.
I want to thank again the New School, Lori Lynn Turner and Louise Jaramillo, and of course, our great panelists. Thank you, Zakia, for moderating. Metta, amazing. Tim, equally so. Thank you so much. I want to encourage you all to come out to our other events coming up and also to apply to the Toy Derricotte and Cornelius Edie Chapbook Prize. The deadline is September 30th. So if you're a Black poet in any stage of your career, please apply to that Chapbook Prize. Again, thank you. Stay and speak to the poets, eat the food, drink the wine, and have a good time. Thank you so much.